There haven't been an awful lot of films like this, not kind of a scientific documentary. There's been travelogue documentaries and the March of the Penguins, you know, kind of focusing on one species, that sort of thing, but kind of a general scientific look at a continent that very few of us will ever get to see in our lives was kind of missing. And what we saw here in Antarctica was a lot of the marine life was diminishing in population numbers, and quite the opposite was taking place in the Arctic. I was very curious about the ozone hole, because that was the only place in Antarctica where they were measuring it. And that's the other bit of new information I wanted to pass on. You heard there were three countries that didn't sign the Montreal Protocol in the film. They have signed by now. And so that makes that document the world's only internationally, unilaterally signed piece of legislation. Every single country in the world has agreed to ban CFCs. This is the idea, is that it's supposed to present a little bit of hope in an environmental crisis such as climate change, where there seems to be no hope at all. Having an earlier precedent that actually worked, coming from a piece of legislation that the world agreed to, is very hopeful that we can do it again. Last July, there was a crack about 19 miles long that finally severed and discharged an iceberg about the size of Singapore, or twice the size of Atlanta. But there was actually a bigger piece of ice that broke off of the Petermann Glacier in the Arctic. That piece of ice represented about a quarter of the size of the entire glacier. And the piece of ice that actually broke off was five times the size of Manhattan. And at the time, it was known as the largest piece of free-floating ice in polar history. So the volume of fresh water that's now entering the salt water is happening quite suddenly when you get a big chunk of ice breaking off. What they were worried about in this film was the melting of the ice and the slow trickle of water. But all that gets exaggerated when you have a big chunk of ice break off, like we've seen in the past couple of years. I actually saw a piece of the Petermann Ice Island a year and a half after I first saw the big one off the coast of Newfoundland. So they do break up when they come in contact with warmer temperatures. The title of this talk is Connecting the Docks, Bridging the Gap Between Science and Policy with Film. And the reason I called it that is because that's what the UN found actually works. A well-made documentary showing the scientists in their field discussing their findings in that medium was considered not only reliable but also accessible and easier to understand. The UN has created a partnership with me to create a climate documentary film showcasing the global scientists that study this thing every year. It's called the Youth Climate Report. And what we do is we get university students around the world to interview their climate scientists, their climate researchers where they live, and report their latest findings. And we put all those little snippet interviews together in about a 45-minute film. If the information needs to get out to people outside of academia, then it has to be presented in a different way. And if it's not written in a different way, then perhaps a different medium needs to be employed to get that information out to the average person who's not a scientist. And that's what the UN found, was that film achieved that. Because those people are not scientists, they're politicians, and they need not to have it dumbed down, but just to have it explained to them at a level that they can understand.